To Windows on the World with me, Mark Windows, bringing you cutting-edge news, empowering information and no conspiracy theories. On today's show, I'm going to be talking to author Adrian Gilbert, whose many books include The Orion Mystery, The Mayan Prophecies, Secrets of the Stone of Destiny, The Holy Kingdom, Shadow of the Dragon, to name but a few. Adrian joins us in the studio to talk about his new book, The Blood of Avalon, The True King Arthur. Welcome, Adrian.
How are you?
Very well, actually. And I've been really looking forward to this because I've read the book, The Blood of Avalon, The Secret History of the Grail Dynasty, and it's absolutely fascinating. Can you just tell us a bit how you came into this particular area of research into King Arthur?
Oh, that's a big story. How much time have you got? No, well, as you mentioned, I wrote another book called The Holy Kingdom, which I co-authored with two other authors, Alan Wilson and Baron Blackett. And that was all about King Arthur and linking him with Wales. You know, people don't tend to realise this, but the Welsh are the descendants of the ancient Romano-Britons. The British people then would have spoken something that was probably Welsh, or something very similar to Welsh. That the Anglo-Saxons, the English, such as me, came a bit later, right, after the Romans had gone. So King Arthur actually was fighting the English. He wasn't an English king. So if you're going to find the truth about him, the place to look is within sort of Wales and within Welsh literature. And there's an amazing amount of material there. There are archives of family trees, pedigrees, old bits of pieces of history, genealogies of saints, and all of this. And a lot of it's actually in the British Library if people would only go and have a look. And these guys introduced me to it. To this whole story and the whole concept of King Arthur being, or there being a King Arthur, we think there may be more than one, who was a king in South Wales, within what we now call Glamorgan. So that got me interested in that whole idea. And we wrote the book, The Holy Kingdom, and then I wanted to follow that up and see what happened after King Arthur. What happened to his dynasty? What happened to the people who are descended from him following up to the present day? So that's really where this book, or what this book is about.
Well, it's very interesting because a lot of people believe that the real seat of King Arthur was Glastonbury. Can you tell us a bit how you found out that it wasn't?
Yes. Now, Glastonbury, now, don't get me wrong on this. I mean, I'm very fond of Glastonbury. I was actually married in Glastonbury in a church there. I used to go there quite regularly, and I love the church ruins there, you know, the Great Abbey. So I'm not a Glastonbury phobe by any stretch of the imagination. However, when I started investigating this, I discovered that they'd not actually found anything that dated before the 10th century, around about 940. And in fact, there was a big dig was done during the First World War by a guy called Bly Bond. He was brought in by the church authorities to investigate the ruins of Glastonbury Abbey, and they did digs there, and he was actually very, very keen, you know, to find this Arthurian Glastonbury that everyone has talked about, and the old Wattle Church and all that. He found nothing before the ruins of a church of dedicated to St. Dunstan and built for King Edgar, who was the king. Right, so it looks as though the Glastonbury, the whole Glastonbury legends, date really from that time that Dunstan was around. He was born near there, and he was the first abbot of Glastonbury, although it's recorded, and that it was done by Edgar wanting to take this legend, plant it safely in Somerset under his control, yeah, and build these things on top of it. And then in the 12th century, more was done in that direction. They had a big fire. The monks needed to get money to rebuild their church. Lo and behold, they dig up some bones and say, oh, we found King Arthur's bones, you know. King Arthur and Guinevere buried here. And Edward I was really into this idea. I mean, he'd been fighting the Welsh. He came along and said, yeah, definitely King Arthur. So let's build a big shrine here. So they built a big shrine. They put the bones in the shrine. And then this becomes a massive place of pilgrimage for people coming in. You know, because we all like to go and see something, don't we? All, you know, when you go somewhere, you want something to go and say, oh, wow, you know, I saw the tomb of King Arthur.
So yeah. The whole thing's a massive false flag operation.
Yes. Not entirely. The one difference is that one of the things I discovered is that Glastonbury, comes from Welsh, yeah? That the glass means green or blue. And they're actually talking about a green or blue hill. Yeah, and it's Bryn Glas in Welsh. And you find there's actually quite a lot of Bryn Glases around in Wales. And I can imagine that maybe this was called the Bryn Glas in Glastonbury, but it's not the one. For one thing, the Aberglaston, so-called, yeah, that's what they call it in the old Welsh texts. Aber is where there's a confluence of two rivers, or a river is running into an estuary. Yeah, there's no confluence at Glastonbury. There's a little brook running quite near, but that is actually not real either. That was built in the time of King Charles II when they were draining the marshes. So there was no river running through there, and there was no confluence. Yet when you go to Wales, it's a different story. But I don't want to jump the gun and go before myself.
It's absolutely fascinating. And
the way history has been presented, and when we look at it, we can see that these timelines often don't make sense once you start doing some investigation. So why do you think this has been buried?
Well, I think there's a very good reason for that within the Welsh literature, now I don't speak Welsh, but fortunately quite a lot has been translated, and so you can read it, but also there are bits and pieces, you know, certain names and things, it's not that hard to get a grasp on, place names and things like that. But you can imagine that Wales was not conquered by the Anglo-Saxons, you realise that? It was not until the Normans came along that Wales was brought under the crown. And they had a lot of traditions of their own about King Arthur and that he was going to come back. Yeah, that there would be, you know, the once and future king, yeah, who was going to restore their fortunes. They had prophecies. If you get a book called The History of the Kings of Britain by Geoffrey of Monmouth, now, when you get that, there's a Penguin edition of this, right? And I'm sure you may be seeing it. And it starts off, you read the foreword and say, well, of course, Geoffrey was inventing all this fake history. And they loved it at the time. Not true, yeah? Geoffrey tells us himself he was translating an old Welsh book. And actually, that old Welsh book still exists. It's called the Brut Tassilio. If anyone takes the trouble to actually investigate this, they'll find out that Geoffrey quite definitely was not the inventor of this history. The history that he wrote, what he did is he took the Welsh annals. You know, annals just means like a diary. You know, each year they write down what happened that year. We have the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, which is a similar kind of annals for the Anglo-Saxons. They had them in Wales. And he took those annals and he translated them into Latin. Yeah, for the court, and he embellished them, right? So, for instance, there's a story where a king called Arviragus marries a lady, a princess called Genoissa, right? And in the annals, it just says you know, the king married, King Arthur Regis married Genoissa, right? That's end of story. In Geoffrey's version, and the king was so in love, and you know, and she was so beautiful, you know, and it was a gorgeous, lovely day, and it's lovely when, you know, he embellished it, yeah, made it a bit more romantic, yeah, as you would do, wouldn't you? You know, you're selling it. You want to sell your book to your Norman nobility. Yeah, you're not going to say, well, you know, they got married. Yeah, they were saying, well, give us a bit more.
Did he slay a dragon by any chance?
So when they say he invented it, no, he didn't, but he did embellish. And when you go into that book, I've digressed a bit here, there's another book inserted in it, which is a completely different book, which is called The Prophecies of Merlin, right? And Geoffrey tells us this. He says, look, I took the prophecies of Merlin, I've translated those as well. Boom, they're in the side, in the middle of the book. The prophecies of Merlin, it's all about dragons fighting. You're mentioning dragons. There's two. Merlin has a dream. Merlin was a boy, supposedly had no father. Right? Well, probably what that really meant was he was illegitimate. But yeah. The way the legend developed, oh, he must have had a fairy. That was
divine.
He was divine, you know. Yeah. No, actually, probably, you know. Anyway, he's taken to the court of the king, who's trying to build a castle. Every time he's Vortigern, this is King Vortigern, he's trying to build his castle, and they build them, you know, the stones, and each day they build some, and then overnight it falls down, right? And they keep doing it. So, oh my God, you know, can't you? So he goes to his druids or his priests or whoever they were, and he says to them, look, you know, what's going on here? And they sort of cast auguries or, you know, do a horoscope or whatever they do. And they say, look, what you've got to do is you've got to find a boy who's got no father, slaughter him and pour his blood over the bricks, and then it will stand up. So you think, oh, brilliant idea, right? They get hold of Merlin, drag him off up there, and they're going to kill him, right, and sprinkle his blood over the bricks. And he says, hang on a minute. Your guys don't know what they're talking about, he said. You know, ask them what's underneath that wall, why it won't stand up. And they said, well, we don't know what's under there. And he said, well, I'll tell you what's under there. There's an underground pool under there. And they dig down, they find, sure enough, there's an underground pool there. And he says, but in the bottom of that pool, there's two stones. Yeah, what's in there? And they said, well, we don't know. He said, well, I'll tell you, there's two dragons. They take the stones out, and the dragons come out of the stones. And then the prophecies of Merlin is the two dragons fight. There's the red dragon of Wales, and we all know, yeah, Dragoch of Wales. Yeah, we see it on the flag. Yeah, but there's a white dragon. Now, have you thought about that? The white dragon is the English. And have you ever looked at the symbol of London and the dragon supporters?
Oh yes.
Yeah, they're silver. Silver and white are congruent colours in heraldry, just as red and gold are, yeah? So the red dragon is gold, the silver dragon is white, yeah? And they fight for supremacy within the island. And first one's on top, then the other, and it goes backwards and forwards. But the Welsh, the prophecies of Merlin say that eventually the Welsh dragon will win. Now you can imagine how that goes down over the River Severn, you know, they're not going to like it, are they?
No, so we're talking about a big propaganda exercise here.
Exactly,
really,
exactly. Both sides propaganda exercise, yeah? Uther Pendragon, yeah? Remember he had the golden dragon on his helmet, yeah? It's the same thing, you know, the Welsh dragon. Anyway, Henry VII, of course, he comes out, he carries the Dragoch banner into battle, yeah, to rally the Welsh. And they see him, ah, he's fulfilling the legends, yeah? At last, we have a Welsh king, yeah? Because his father was, you know, descended from Welsh nobility, yeah? He was of the royal dynasty, going back to Llywelyn's time. So when Henry VII came along, of course he carries the Welsh flag, and that flag is now the flag of Wales. And the Tudor dynasty was essentially a Welsh dynasty.
We're going to take a short break now. We're going to see you in a couple of minutes. Absolutely fascinating. I'm talking to Adrian Gilbert about his new book, The Blood of Avalon. See you in a couple of minutes.
At Wembley Arena, and I'll tell you this, control system, you ain't seen nothing yet.
The fascist global state is not coming because we're not having it anymore. No way! No more fear. We are all one. People are waking up. The beginning is here. Awaken.
Welcome back to Windows on the World. I'm with Adrian Gilbert. We're talking about his book, The Blood of Avalon, and we're talking about the real King Arthur. So welcome back, Adrian. And we're going to talk now about the Holy Kingdom, this kingdom of Arthur in Wales.
Yes. Well, as I was saying earlier, that I came into this whole subject area when I was asked to co-author a book with two other researchers who've been working on this for many years, this whole subject of King Arthur and looking into all these different saint stories and genealogies and legends. But they'd done more than that. They had, when during their searches around, they had identified a particular old ruined chapel on a hillside, which they believed was Arthur's final resting place. And the reason they thought that was that, first of all, they found a big stone. It stands about that high, and it's sort of slightly pointed, and it, it's sort of rough shaped, and it has scratched on it, Rex Artorius Fili Mauricius. Now, the King Arthur that we're talking about was indeed an Arthur son of Maurice, Mauricius, in Latin. In Welsh, they call him Moirig. And Arthur, they were called Arthruis. So in the genealogies, you find Arthruis Map Moirig, or Ap Moirig, Arthur, son of Maurice, who is also the son of Tewdrig in Welsh, which we would call Theodoric, or Theodoricus. So there's this genealogy going back. And they found this stone with Rex Artorius Fili Mauricius written on it. It's not perfect Latin. You can imagine if it was someone's second language, they're speaking Welsh normally, they're writing it in Latin, perhaps they're a church person, that would explain it. Anyway, they identified this building. They thought, right, well, we think this is where he's buried. So they went to the church commissioners, the Church of England in Wales, I think they call it, and they bought this chapel from them. And its sort of surrounding area. And then they, after a lot of hassle, the authorities down there were very reluctant to allow any of this work to progress. As far as they were concerned, this is just a Norman building. It's of no interest to anybody. Just leave it. Sheep can graze among it. It's all fallen down. Doesn't matter. Soon it'll be gone completely, and thank goodness for that. That's the attitude of the archaeological establishment in Wales. Anything pre-Norman, it must be Roman if it's of any value at all. There was nothing of any value between the Norman time and the Romans. So if it's Roman, that's great, fantastic, love the Romans. If it's Norman, fantastic, okay, that's great, good stuff, Norman. Anything that's in between, what we would call Dark Ages, Arthurian period, deeply suspect, don't want to know. Destroy it, get rid of it, obliterate it. That's the attitude, unfortunately, down there.
Yeah, so that sounds like they've kind of done a good job of burying their own.
Totally, yeah. You go and see old memorial stones, really old, And you read the names, sometimes they have dedications on them. And you read the names on some of these stones. And when you start looking into the Dark Age history of actual individuals, then you find them. I'll give you an example. There's a famous stone called the Bodvok Stone. Yeah, it's on top of Margam Mountain originally. And it says, written on it, what's left of it, the shaft, which is now in a little museum in Margam Abbey, what was Margam Abbey, now a country park there. There's a little museum there of these stones. And it says, written on it, Hic Yachit Bodvok, Felius Catotigernus, Nepus Vidomai Eternalis. I think that's what it says. Now, when you go into this, right, it says, right, there's a guy here called Bodvok. Actually, that V wouldn't be pronounced like a V, it'd be pronounced like a U. So it'd be Hic Yachit Bodvok. Yeah, Boduk, something like that. Bit like Boudica, probably the same root name. It tells us he's the son of someone called Catotigernus. Well, we know who Catotigernus is when we read the history. He's Catigern. Yeah? Tigern actually means kind of like a small king. Yeah? And we know from the history that Catigern was one of the sons Vortigern. Yeah? Catigern actually fought a battle against Hengist and Horsa in Kent. You remember Hengist and Horsa invaded, they came over with the Saxons, first three boatloads of Saxons, and Vortigern said, well, I actually need some people to defend me from the Picts. The Picts, you know, he'd done horrible things to his bodyguard of Picts, and the Picts wanted revenge. So he said, look, you come work for me, you deal with my Pict problem, yeah, we'll be friends. Well, they dealt with his Pict problem, and then they had made an agreement with him. I'm digressing here, but it's fun. They'd said before that, all we want is a piece of land that can be covered by one ox hide. And he said, oh, an ox hide, okay. We'll give you the land that can be covered by an ox hide. But what he hadn't, Hengist was a clever guy. Yeah, he was very smart. What they did is they took the ox hide and they snipped very, very thin strand, all the way around. They made this enormously long rope and stretched it out. I said, right, that's my piece of land in Thanet. Yeah. So Hengist, that's how they got their foothold in Thanet. This is probably just a legend, but you get the meaning. Then, of course, Hengist and Horsa, they saw how weak this British king was. So they called to all their mates, come on over. Great stuff here, This place is so weak and undefended. We can help ourselves. So then they took over East Kent first. And then they fought a battle north of Maidstone, round about where Aylesford is now. And Catigern fought hand to hand with Hengist's brother, who's called Horsa, and they both died in the battle. And there's a dolmen structure there, which is supposed to be the grave of Catigern. Yeah, they call it Kit's Coity. Yeah, Kit's Cat Coity, I think it's called. Well, of course, it predates him by long chalk, but maybe he was buried there after the battle. Yeah, so Catigern, we know who Catigern was. It doesn't tell us who his grandfather was, Bodvox, but it tells us who his great-grandfather was. And we know who he is. He's called Guido, and he's the father of Vortigern. So they don't tell us about Vortigern. Vortigern's a disgrace. You don't put his name on your gravestone. You put your great-grandfather on, yeah? And you put your own father on, but you leave out the granddad, who's Vortigern, because he's a disgrace. Yet, there's no mention. You go into this museum and look at this stone, there's no mention of any of this history. It's just...
It's a very good analogy for what we're talking about, though, isn't it?
Yeah. They'll say, this stone works, probably Norman. There's a whole load of other stones there. The way they phrase it is this. They say, look, carving wheelstones wheel crosses, that was obviously invented in Ireland, right? So the Irish took it to Scotland, the Scots took it to Northumberland, and then they must have brought it to Wales. They forget something. Actually, St. Patrick was Welsh. He would have seen crosses like that before he went to Ireland, took the idea there, and then it got taken from there to Scotland and to Northumberland. It's the other way round. So these stones, which a lot of which they say, oh, well, these are 10th century, they can't have been any earlier than that because we haven't got earlier ones than that up in Northumberland.
So it looks as though the whole history of King Arthur has been buried, really, by neglect.
Totally. And ignorance. As my friend Alan Wilson likes to say, they have the enormous advantage of total ignorance. You know, these archaeologists who come there, they come with a classical education, yeah, they've learned English history, yeah, they're then given a post in Cardiff University as professor. They don't know any Welsh history, they don't care anyway, yeah, they don't think it has any history worth knowing, and so they interpret everything they see through the spectacles of what they've been taught themselves at Oxford, which was probably rubbish.
They find what they're looking for, basically.
They find what they're looking for. They don't understand because they don't... And as he says, if you want to understand the history of a place, you need to understand the dynasties. Yeah? If you're looking at stones, if you went into Egypt, right? I've been to Egypt lots of times. And you go around, you start looking around, you find something, cartouche that says Ramesses, yeah? You know pretty well, oh yeah, there was a guy called Ramesses. He was a pretty big builder, yeah? A bit of a big ego, probably him, yeah? Or it says Seti, yeah? Oh yeah, that was Ramesses' dad, yeah, that would be him. Or Thothmeses, yeah? Oh yeah, yeah, we know about him, yeah? You wouldn't start saying, oh well, you know, this must be built by the Romans, yeah? In imitation of something else. You wouldn't say that, would you? Because you know the history. You know the individuals involved. Or at least you've got some idea. Well, they ignore the Welsh genealogies. They think they're total nonsense. They ignore the whole traditional history of Wales, which incidentally claims that they came as immigrants from Troy. Yeah? Well, that must be nonsense, mustn't it? I mean, how could the British ever come from Troy? Well, Schliemann actually discovered Troy. Unfortunately, the people who said, well, how could the British ever come from Troy, were saying that before Schliemann discovered it. Yeah? When they assumed that Troy itself was just an invention of Homer. Yeah? The blind Greek poet. Oh, yeah, he invented Troy. Yeah, didn't it really exist? Well, excuse me, we now know it did exist. They claim that there was a migration from that area. Yeah? And that they are descended from them. And once you begin to take that on board and say, well, actually, yeah, we ought to take a bit more seriously what these people are saying, then things start slotting into place and you begin to see a whole different history of the island of Britain from the one that's generally peddled to us as barbarians until the good old Romans came along and taught them some civilization. And then the Romans go, oh, barbarians again. Yeah, fortunately the Anglo-Saxons come along and do some good stuff, and then even better, the Normans come and build some wonderful churches and castles, yeah? Which is how we're taught history.
Yeah. Well, it's a similar thing to younger people, I suppose, or people of our age, of like, well, nothing happened before the Beatles.
Exactly, yeah, nothing happened before the Beatles, you know? Nothing happened before William the Conqueror. I mean, you know, I mean, we even lampoon it. We call it 1066 and all that, don't we?
Yes.
Yeah? We don't know anything about Edmund Ironside or Alfred the Great, except that he burnt cakes. Yeah? We don't know anything about these people, but they've been thrown in the dustbin of history. And the entire history of Wales has been taken and dropped in the dustbin. Got rid of that. Yeah? Start again.
It's absolutely terrible. But the thing is that what I don't understand about academics and people who wanted to study history in the first place don't want to actually find out about it.
Exactly.
I find that really strange because...
Especially Welsh ones.
Yes. Yeah. So the people of Wales, yes, look into your own history, please.
Well, I've given you a few hints.
You certainly have. It's a fascinating book. And I'd just like to go on to this area of Coity, a suburb of Bridgend, actually, really, yes. Now, isn't it? Which yes. Which is the seat of where this King Arthur actually was.
Yes.
Yeah. Could you talk a bit yes. about that now?
Well, it's a very interesting place, Coity. When the Normans came to invade Wales, right, there was a battle between the King of Glamorgan and the King of Dyfed, which is southwest Wales, Pembrokeshire area. They were having a battle, and it wasn't going too well for the Glamorgan guy. So he called on his neighbour, right, who was the Earl of Gloucester, Norman noble, called Sir Robert Fitzhamon, asked him for help. Now, that's a stupid thing to do, right? You never ask the Normans for help. Never. Anyway, he asked him to come and help him, and they defeated the other guy, and then the Normans said, oh, well, bye-bye, nice to meet you, and sort of got in their boats, sailed over the horizon, yeah, or a bit up the Severn, waited till Yestin, the King of Glamorgan, had stood his men down, then they came straight back and seized the plain of Glamorgan. Yeah, and took all the castles and manors there, and Yestin they took prisoner. Some accounts he died. Other accounts say he was taken back to Keynsham Abbey near Bristol, where he died.
This is absolutely fascinating, Adrian. We're going to take another short break now. It's a short break now. This is Windows on the World with Adrian Gilbert talking about his new book, The Blood of Avalon: The Real King Arthur. We'll see him in a couple of minutes. Welcome to Windows on the World with me, Mark Windows. Reports of your death were greatly exaggerated then.
As soon as I was going out the door, she says, all right, Johnny Delirious, you go outside that door, you're a dead man.
Got a warrant to search for and remove you from your place of residence, and have they also arrested your wife? Is that right?
That's right, they did it.
We have in the studio David Compan, NHS electrician, just released after being sectioned under the Mental Health Act. If you weren't with anybody, you'd have just disappeared. Nobody yes. would know where you are, and you can be detained indefinitely.
That's right. Mm. Thank you very much for all your support. Thank you very much.
Thanks, David. Our next guest, Nazrin, was evicted from her own property. This was due to a management company issuing charges which she disputed.
The lady called for assistance from the police, and she's now been arrested, handcuffed, took out of her own home.
The student loans, the debt book has been sold. All of what we've talked about is coming your way. Oh
my goodness. Sergeant,
have a seat. Don't
actually
necessarily go into a police station at this time.
What has she been arrested for?
Breach of
the breach. Well, that video was very shocking because Nazrin was actually peacefully occupying her own property and she was arrested for breach of the peace in her own house.
It's very painful to watch because in that instance, I realised something terrible is happening in this country.
We did a show about people getting their doors kicked in by the police on behalf of private interests without proper court warrants, and this is actual fact. This is happening.
It's illegal and it's corrupt, and you have to ask yourself, why are the people who are willing to bust in people's doors, what the hell happened to them?
You actually called me after they were smashing the door.
Yeah.
We actually got a phone call into their press office, and first of all they said the police would never do that. However, they've been caught on video doing just that. The second time we called, they said if the police did that, it would be criminal damage. So you've just witnessed criminal damage by the police. Welcome back to Windows on the World. We're with Adrian Gilbert talking about King Arthur, the Blood of Avalon. Welcome back, Adrian.
Hello, again. Yeah.
Very fascinating. I'm finding this really informative too, and I would recommend that anybody who's interested in British history, especially Welsh history, to buy this book, because it's very revealing. Now, we were going to talk about Coity, a suburb now, yes. Bridgend, which is the true seat of King Arthur. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Coity is a fascinating place. I'll tell you a little story first, right? The as you know, the Normans conquered England in 1066 and built castles all over the place. They didn't conquer Wales then, and it wasn't until 1092, roughly, that there was a war in between two princes in Wales. The Welsh were always fighting each other, and the king in Glamorgan area asked his neighbour, Sir Robert Fitzhamond, who was the Earl of Gloucester, for help. Now, Sir Robert Fitzhamond was a Norman, and you don't do that. That, you know, it's a really, really stupid thing to do, to invite the Normans in, because you never get them out again. Anyway, he asked him for help, and he came along and with his knights, and they defeated the other guy and killed him in battle. And then the Normans got in their boats, supposedly sailing off, and Yestinap Gergan, the king of Glamorgan, stood his men down. And the Normans, they got a signal that he had done that. Then they came straight back with their boats, seized the castles and the manors of the Vale of Glamorgan, including Cardiff Castle. And Fitzhamond made himself the new Lord of Glamorgan. Right? That's a great thing for him because, you see, Wales was outside of the Kingdom of England. Now, so if you owned a piece of real estate there, you didn't own it feudally from your overlord, the king. So you were effectively number one. So Sir Robert Fitzhamond, in seizing territory in Wales as a marcher lord, he was establishing himself as a little petty king in his own right. He didn't have to pay taxes on that land to his overlord. Anyway, so he shared out the castles and manors among his knights, the knights of despoliation. But there was one who was left out, and his name was called Sir Payne de Turbeville. And the story goes that he had had a fight with Sir Payne before, and Sir Payne had hit him so hard that he was deaf in one ear after it. And he told Sir Payne, go and find your own. Yeah. So Sir Payne took his men, and they laid siege. They went to the north part, north edge of the Vale of Glamorgan, found a little castle there called Coity. They laid siege to it. And the Lord of Coity was either grandson or great-grandson of Yestin. Yestin was a very old man, the king of Glamorgan, over 100 when he died. And they laid siege to the castle, and Morgan, seeing them there, thought it was a pity that blood should be shed. So he went out with his through the castle door with his sword in one hand and his daughter, Sarah, holding her hand in the other, challenged Sir Payne de Turbeville to either fight him man to man to decide the issue or marry his daughter. And Sir Payne wasn't a fool. He married the daughter. But by doing that, he then received that castle in marriage lawfully under Welsh law, and he would then pay a gold coin per year to his overlord, Welsh king or the descendant of the Welsh king, as a token gesture, sort of peppercorn rent as it were, and he had control of Coity, and that meant Coity was tax free. So when you read in the stories about Avalon, the fields of Avalon were tax-free, this is what it's really talking about. And that continued right up until 1405, time of Owen Glendower, and the time when Henry V, who was at that time Prince of Wales, came to relief of Coity against Owen Glendower, but that's another story. Anyway, this area here, Coity, was the last place. I mean, Sir Payne married the daughter of Morgan, and two others of their descendants also married into the royal Welsh line. So this, the Turbervilles, were of the lineage, right, descended from the ancient kings of Wales, and going right back, also down another line, to a lady called Anna, who's listed in the genealogies, and she's called a cousin of the Virgin Mary. You'll read this in a number of different lineages. You can go, if you don't believe me, go to the British Library, and you will find books there which give these genealogies, particularly the Harleian 3859 black book. You'll find that there. It's written on vellum, which is sheepskin. It stinks. It's written in tiny letters. I've looked at this book myself. When you go to the back of it, it contains loads of other stuff, but you go to the back, you find all these genealogies there, and amongst them you will find the statement that this lady was the cousin of the Virgin Mary. Now, what does that mean? I think it means that she's descended from Mary's brother, either a brother or uncle, who we know as Joseph of Arimathea. Yeah? And so you've got the whole Grail legend connection there. I know lots of people have been writing about, did Jesus marry Mary Magdalene? Did they have a child? And was he in France? La, la, la. There's nothing in the Bible that tells us this. But in these ancient Welsh genealogies, they tell us of this cousin of the Virgin Mary and how she married into the royal family of Wales, and that they are the Grail dynasty. And now also within this territory owned by Coity is this ancient chapel that my friends found, which they believe King Arthur's buried in. And I told you they found this big stone there with Rex Artoris, Filii Mauricius, written on it. Also, they carried out an archaeological dig there. Not personally, they brought in archaeologists, I think from Glasgow University, actually, to oversee a dig. And in the course of this dig, they found a sequence of buildings on this site. So the present church ruins are only the latest of a number of buildings being on that site. And one of them was a sort of round structure, perhaps a sort of beehive hermitage structure, which was reckoned to be from the 6th century, which is the King Arthur time. Right? Now, right in the middle of that structure, they found a votive cross made of silver with some other metals, a bit of copper, I think, and one or two other bits in there, but mostly silver. And it has written on it, Pro Anima Artorius. Well, Pro Anima means for the soul. So it means for the soul Arthur. So it's a votive cross there for Arthur's soul. Now, this is interesting because this place in Welsh is called Llan Bedr. Yeah? Now in Welsh, now I don't speak Welsh, but I know a little bit, enough to know this, that very often when they join words together, the first letter of the second word is mutated, it's changed. So they have a name, Peter, which means Peter, yeah? And they have another word, Llan. Llan means an enclosure, but it also means church. You put the two together and the P becomes a B. So it comes Llan Bedr. Now, I believe that there is this character we come across in the Arthurian legends, which in English we call Sir Bedivere. You must have heard of Sir Bedivere. He's the one who throws the sword into the lake, yeah, after he's tempted to keep it. In Welsh, he's called Bedr, yeah, B-E-D-W-Y-R. The W is pronounced more like a double O, and the Y is an E sound. Yeah, it's a Bedr. Yeah. Now, I think that's an alternative version of Bedr, mutated from Peder. So Bedr, or Bedivere, is actually Peter, which makes a lot of sense. You know, there's nobody else called Bedivere, is there? Or Bedwere. I mean, but there's lots of people called Peter. And Peter, of course, was, you know, a very important saint. And it's still, the church there on that hill is called St. Peter's on the Mountain in English. Now, that's where they found these relics. And if you read the Mort d'Arthur, it tells us how Sir Bedivere went after Arthur had been taken to Avalon for burial. He went and he found this little hermitage where there was an old monk there who had been the Archbishop of Canterbury. And he tells him, yes, very important man buried here, actually it's Arthur. And Sir Bedivere decides he's going to devote the rest of his days to living there in prayer as a hermit along where his master Arthur had died, yeah, where he's buried. So we've got a hermitage, we've got a place where there's a silver votive cross, yeah, in the middle of it, and it belonged to the Lords of Coity. Yeah. And this is the last lordship to retain Welsh lineage right up until 1405. And I think they preserved the secret. They were happy for the English to think Glastonbury is where he's buried. Yeah, they were happy about that. Let them think it, you know, we know he's actually here. And we're not going to tell anyone. And I think they kept it in the family.
That would make a lot of sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
That would make perfect sense.
Yes, absolutely. Why else, you know, would you keep renovating this church on a mountain, you know? And there's also other things that connect with the whole Avalonian Glastonbury legend. There's a place called Clan Ilid, where there's a circular earthwork. Wonderful, romantic place, trees. If you go there in May, all the bluebells are out. It's a fantastic atmosphere. This, according to legend, is where Joseph Arimathea preached. In Wales, they call Joseph Arimathea St. Ilid, right? And this place is called Clan Ilid, the Church of Ilid. And there is actually a later church near it, but the earthwork is where he would have preached. It's a sacred circle. Church, the word church comes from the Greek kirkos, which means a circle. It doesn't mean a building made of stones, you know, and cross shape. Yeah? Kirkus, yeah? Yeah, in Scotland they're still called a kirk, don't they? It means a circle. So originally they would have constructed circles, sacred circles. There's something very ancient about this, you know. Even Stonehenge is basically a sacred circle with things going on inside it. Yeah? This is an ancient thing in Britain, but probably in other places too. But the original church would have been the circle. And they would have gathered there for their meetings, yeah, because in under old Druidic law, you couldn't hold a religious festival or a ceremony when the sun was set, because the sun was the eye of God. And so if you were doing things when the sun is set, then God's not able to see what you're doing. Yeah, God should be watching. So you do it when the sun is out. But that's a whole other.
Well, it's very fascinating that this secret's been preserved.
Yes.
Really, probably through an oral tradition.
Yes.
Within the circle of the
Absolutely.
People who knew it.
Yes.
So the question is really, is why has nobody else looked into this, Adrian?
Search me. I don't know. I mean, I was amazed when Alan and Barham showed me what they had, and then I followed up the leads on this. And I'm not going to give you everything that's in the book because I want you to read it.
Well, we wouldn't have time for that today anyway, no. But I'd recommend to anybody to read this book because I've read it. It's absolutely fascinating. We're going to take another short break now. We'll see you in a couple of minutes. In your opinion, do you think the jury was led?
It's not mine to say.
Very diplomatic.
Tell the viewers a bit about what happened to you.
Well, they bribed three criminals to come in and give hearsay.
If a bomb went off in London and took 92 lives, yeah, would you want to be on the payroll of that?
It's all based on models and projections.
It's all over Barbashevsky.
In order to get me in prison, they probably broke, you know, a couple dozen laws.
Free Yolanda. Y'all planted drugs on Yolanda, and we're going to get her released and get the crooked cops busted.
That gave all the officers time for their adrenaline to slow down so we wouldn't get shot.
Just for the viewers out there who may not know about this story, when did you discover this pyramid?
In April of 2005, I first came to the little Bosnian town of Visoko.
When you drive someone to take their own life, like the CSA have done, I mean, that's an abomination.
Thanks for being on Windows on the World.
Peace to London.
The rest is history, and everybody called me delirious after that.
Bringing you cutting-edge news, empowering information, and no conspiracy theories.
So convince the sceptical public about geoengineering.
Well, basically, the weather has been experimented with since 1928. There was a process for producing artificial fogs, a US patent. Like I say, 1928, that's so we're just under 90 years of weather modification experiment.
Welcome back to Windows on the World. I'm talking to author Adrian Gilbert about his fascinating new book, The Blood of Avalon. Welcome back, Adrian.
Hi.
So, yeah, we've covered quite a lot of ground so far about the origins of the real King Arthur and the area in Wales in which he was buried and the church, which was originally a hermitage.
Yes.
So we've got a lot of evidence here, haven't we?
Yes. There's one crucial piece of evidence that we've left out so far, which is the identity of Camelot. You know, King Arthur, why would King Arthur be without Camelot? Now, back in the 1960s, a bunch of archaeologists from Cardiff University went out to Somerset and started digging up a hill fort at South Cadbury. And they found some remnants there of what they believe was reuse at the time of the Anglo-Saxon invasions. They said, aha, this must be Camelot. Well, I don't think so, somehow. I mean, put yourself in the shoes of King Arthur, right? Romans have gone, right? Generation or two before you. But the Romans didn't live in hill forts, right? The Romans lived in very nice villas and towns. But they had cities. They're listed, if you look in various pieces of historical books. Some of them still exist today, like Colchester, for instance. But where would King Arthur's Camelot have been? Well, there are clues within the ancient legends about King Arthur that tell us exactly where it must have been. And the first one is about him being crowned. Right? He was crowned, we're told, by Bishop Dubricius, who's called Duffrig in Welsh, Saint Duffrig. And he was archbishop in Caerleon, right?
This is and the bit of the jigsaw puzzle I found most fascinating.
Yes, and he crowns Arthur in Caerleon. And Arthur marries a lady called Guinevere, right? Whose father is called Leo de Grance, King Leo de Grance. Do you remember him? Now, I'm not the first person to recognise that what that comes from is a corruption of the Welsh, Leo de Grand, yeah? Leo the Great. And when you go back in the histories again, you find that there was a king, an ancient British king, called Leo, or Lion, Cleon. Cleon gives his name to Caer Cleon, the castle of Leon. It's not the castle of the legions, as the modern archaeologists and people will tell you. It's not. It's the castle of Leon, right?
That makes perfect sense.
And there's a massive great hill fort above it, which is where Leon, this ancient British king, long before the Romans, probably lived. But in Roman times, there's a lovely town there, and there's still bits of the wall left. And they found all sorts of remains there. And this was one of the last places that the Normans took over. It was a Romano-British centre of occupation and force right up until about 1200. And this is where, I believe, King Arthur had his capital. And his round table was supposed to have been a wedding present given to him on account of his marrying Guinevere. And what do you find in Caerleon? You find a massive round or slightly oblong amphitheater. Now, I don't know if there was a wooden table put in the middle of it, but if you were going to hold a plenary council which is what Arthur does, there would be room enough there for your all your knights and all their men and their wives all to come and sit there and discuss the matters of state.
Yeah, the round table doesn't necessarily have to be an actual table. It's a generic thing.
A table is a flat place. That's what a table is. And there's a round, beautifully left, still existent amphitheatre, Roman amphitheatre in Caerleon, which has got seats enough for about 6,000 people. Now, whether they put a table in the middle, you know, and all sat round and dined, I don't know. Maybe they did. It would have been a perfect place to hold tournaments for knights to practice against one another. It'd be a great place for meeting and discussing affairs of state once a year. You know, they would hold a plenary meeting when all the knights were required to come to court to meet King Arthur, usually on Whitsunday, which is when the Holy Grail is supposed to appear, if you remember. Well, that would be, wouldn't it? Because that's the Feast of the Holy Ghost. You would expect that to be on Whitsunday. So all the pieces of the puzzle, when you start putting them together, you're going to see that this area in Wales has everything that fits the pattern. We have king lists, which include Theodoric, Maurice, Arthur. Yeah, here's a son called Morgan, and it goes on. Yeah. We have the place where he was almost certainly buried. We find a votive cross, Pro Anima Artorius, a tombstone, Rex Artorius, Filii Mauricius, written on it. We've got a place called Coity, where the last principality in Wales, independent, free of taxes, existed right up until 1405. If you want to know what happened after that, you have to read the book. Very interesting. And then we've got Caerleon, which is almost certainly was Camelot. So the whole lot fits together, you know. And that, what do they say? If it looks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. And that's what I feel. And I'm just amazed that nobody bothers with this. It really shocks me, actually.
Well, it is quite shocking, really, because everybody is interested in the legend of King Arthur.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, for instance, my mother came from Merthyr Tydfil. I mean, you must have heard of Merthyr Tydfil, right? Famous coal mining area that had three iron smelting works there. And in the 19th century, it was a very, very prominent town, bigger than Cardiff at that time. But do you know what the name means? Merthyr Tydfil. Merthyr means martyr. Tydfil is Tydfilla, who was one of the daughters of Brucan of Brecon, and she was martyred by Anglo-Saxon invaders along with her father. She's a local saint, yeah, Saint Tydfilla. But people don't ask this, they don't care, they don't know. Brucan of Brecon was a cousin of King Arthur. You can read it in the genealogies. So it's all there. It's on the landscape, it's in the names of the places, it's in the history of Wales. And probably bits of it are in England. I mean, I live in Kent, yeah, not all that far from Kit's Coity, yeah, where Cattigan is supposed to have fought hand to hand with Horsa and they both died. Yeah. There's connections everywhere. And yet this entire genre of history is completely ignored, treated as though it was an invention of medieval monks or nutcases who, for reasons that nobody can fathom, or, you know, several thousand of them wrote books which all kind of dovetailed together. They invented all these genealogies, you know, for their lords and ladies. Yeah, but funny enough, they fit together, you know. And they were doing this evidently for hundreds of years, you know. It's weird, isn't it?
It is, especially as you've got a lot of your information from the British Library.
Absolutely. There's masses of stuff. There's whole genealogies in the British Library. There's masses of stuff there. But nobody looks at it.
Well, somebody has now. I think it's absolutely fascinating, and I would recommend that anybody read this book. I've really enjoyed it, and it's also a great history of that period.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
That's it from Windows on the World for this episode. I'd like to thank Adrian, and his book is available now. It's called The Blood of Avalon, and I would highly recommend it. That's it from Windows on the World. We'll see you soon. Keep watching those, watching us, watching Windows on the World. Remember, it's 9 p.m. Sunday GMT.